It is often those traits in ourselves that we despise the most that we subconsciously then project onto others. In Jungian psychology, it's called the shadow. It's this effect that led me to start the research because I started seeing that actually far-right and Islamist extremists had more in common than they would like to admit. And that this led to a very paradoxical relationship between the two forms of extremism, because they had so many traits in common and so many of the narratives and worldviews they shared that they even complemented each other and that they mutually reinforced each other. I wanted to take a very human approach to it because I felt that extremism and radicalization is such a human process that the best you can do to understand it is to really speak directly to the people involved in it. And so I started by going undercover to two events organized by two diametrically opposed extremist organizations. On the 5th of November, there were two events on the same day. So I started my day by having cider with some people from the English Defense League in the English town of Telford, where they organized a rally against what they call Muslim grooming gangs. And then in the evening of that day, I went to a conference organized by the international Islamist extremist organization Hizb ut-Tahrir. Of course, I was the only non-Muslim there. But they were all very welcoming, and I appreciated that they shared their stories with me. What I found after this day, and when I reflected on the next morning, was that so many of the narratives that they shared with me were quite similar. Whichever event they spoke about, they always related it back to this big master narrative of there is an inevitable war between the two monolithic blocks of Islam and the West, and that there is this either ongoing or imminent conflict of races or cultures. I felt that there might be an interaction between these narratives because obviously they are mutually beneficial to both sides. This was not the only parallel I found, and it's unsurprising to find these narrative parallels when looking at how many of the intellectual elements they also have in common and that they draw sometimes on even the same ideological sources. For example, in 1935, Alexis Carrel published his book L'homme cet inconnu. What most people know is that it served as an inspiration for the pro-fascist regime in France. But what not so many people know is that it also inspired Al-Qaeda's favorite ideologue, Said Qutb, who cited this work almost more than any other. This also means that because they're so close to each other, they sometimes even adopt each other's recruiting strategies and each other's propaganda. So for example, the first far-right group to be banned in the UK, National Action, it modeled its propaganda very much after the propaganda that ISIS produces. And in the same way, they even showed jihadist videos for their training camps, which again imitated the training camp styles of ISIS training camps. On a tactical level, I think the week that saw the Charlottesville attack, and a few days later we had the vehicle attack in Barcelona, that really illustrated some of the tactics that they also have in common. And when I looked at the encrypted messaging apps used by both Islamist extremists and by far-right extremists, they both said, oh, we should use more of these improvised vehicle attacks. That should be our preferred weapon choice, because it's so easy. And it seemed like they almost inspired one another. So in many ways, they're two sides of the same coin. Sometimes they're so close to each other that we even see some very strange conversions. There were multiple cases of neo-Nazis all of a sudden becoming jihadists. That shows really how closely related their worldviews are. There were examples from Germany, from the US, from countries really all across Europe as well. On the other side, we also have very strange connections and relationships. Sometimes they agree on elements, such as anti-Semitic elements, are present in both far-right and Islamist extremists. This was illustrated very well in the attack against the kosher supermarket, the Hyper Kasher, in Paris, in the outskirts of Paris in 2015. You probably remember that happened a few days after the Charlie Hebdo attack. And the perpetrator, which was the ISIS-inspired jihadist Amedi Coulibaly, actually had links, as the police later found, to a person that was associated, was a member of an extreme right group in France. And that was Claude Armand, who was the weapons smuggler for the Kalashnikovs that were used in that attack. It is not just these parallels that are interesting about this paradoxic relationship between the two sides of the extremes, or between probably all forms of extremism. It's also this mutual reinforcement or amplification of each other's narratives. They can use the other side to make a point about how actually all Muslims are terrorists, or how the anti-West is evil, to make a point about how these monolithic blocks, or as they perceive the world, would lead to this inevitable war of races or of cultures. And unfortunately, this is also sometimes reinforced by far-right politicians, by populist politicians, who would also break down the worldviews to this very simplistic view. For example, Marine Le Pen was probed by the police for sharing ISIS propaganda materials, of course, to make a point about Islam being evil. But then also to the same extent, we have cross-references from ISIS side to Trump or to other far-right politicians. They often show them in their propaganda videos, also to make a point about how and the entire West is racist or is Islamophobic. Although I've been studying the evil sides in people pretty much every day, I still believe in the positive sides within every single individual. If we rehumanize the debate around extremism, and probably also stop talking about us and them when talking about extremists and the middle ground, and also re-rationalize the debate, then maybe there is a potential to reverse some of the effects that this has had and how it has ripped apart our societies. And I hope that that's also something, or I think that that is something that where the arts can also play a role in rebuilding the bridges that have been destroyed by these terrorist attacks. Thank you.